It's another episode of the Senator Omer Raines Show. Come join us here at the Reno Town Mall. Get in the audience or get behind a microphone. You can also text in questions at 775-237-2266 to speak with Senator Omer Raines or his guests. That number is 844-790-TALK. Again, it's 844-790-8255. Without further ado, let's get to the creator and host, Senator Omer Raines.
Thank you, Eddie. Good afternoon, folks. I'm Omer Raines, welcoming you to America Matters Media, broadcasting this program to the world, not only in English, but by way of translation in various other languages as well. The programs are being broadcast live on air in the United States and worldwide via various social media applications. Now, this program of my choice is intended to be eclectic in nature. It does not focus solely on one topic or subject matter. However, the guest in whatever field, whatever the point of view, is always interesting and well-informed. Nevertheless, whatever the topic, whomever the guest, we encourage diverse points of view. Okay, Eddie gave you the call-in and text numbers, and with that in mind, I want to introduce today's topic and guest. The topic is March Madness, the most popular sporting event in America, and with the most money laid on betting and participation in public engagement of all the sports. In fact, it's evidenced by the fact that more money is spent during March Madness than on the Super Bowl, the World Series, and all other such events combined. Why? And well, in my opinion, every region of the country is represented in one fashion or another, and it brings in non-basketball fans as well as basketball fans. And any of close to 10 teams usually can win, and there are always some Cinderella teams. There's a lot of parity in basketball. For that reason, I'm going to introduce our guest, because there isn't a better person in America to speak on this than Stan Morrison. Again, possibly the most conversant person in America to speak on today's topic. He was a member of the University of California, Berkeley, 1959 NCAA champions. That was actually the year I entered UC Berkeley. They won the NCAA championship, and that year and the following year, they were NCAA runner-ups. They were defeated that year by Ohio State, that had what turned out to be four Hall of Fame participants, three players and one substitute who later made it as a coach. They had Jerry Lucas, they had John Havlicek, they had Larry Siegfried. Bobby Knight was not a starter, but later was admitted to the Hall of Fame as a coach. Thereafter, Stan became a European All-Star with Real Madrid. As such, he was one of the first Americans to play international basketball. Returning to the States, he became an AAU All-American in 1963, and thereafter he went into coaching. He served as head coach at multiple universities, the University of the Pacific, the University of Southern California Trojans, the San Jose State Spartans. In fact, he is the only coach in NCAA history to lead three universities in the same state to the NCAA basketball tournament. Along the way, he was named Coach of the Year in the Pacific Coast Athletic Association, Coach of the Year in the Pac-10 Conference, Coach of the Year in the Big West Conference, and on and on. Eventually, he became athletic director at the University of California, Santa Barbara. And that was where I think I was first introduced to him, because that's in the middle of my former Senate district. And then thereafter became athletic director at the University of California, Riverside. Of the moment, Stan was a member of the NCAA Women's Basketball Tournament Selection Committee, and thereafter as a member of the NCAA Men's Basketball Tournament Selection Committee. He did that for 5 years. In 2014, he was the American Heart Association's Outstanding Chair Recipient, and in 2017, he was given the prestigious Pete Newell Career Achievement Award for his lifetime of work and career in basketball. As if that isn't enough, Stan has somehow found time to give service to over 25 different nonprofit and humanitarian organizations. So welcome, Stan.
Senator, Thank you so much. Just like I wrote it.
You actually did not write it, but you could have.
Okay. Cecil B. DeMille is rolling over in his grave after that grand introduction. Thank you so very much. That's very kind of you.
Well, look, I'm going to go a bit out of order because University of Nevada, of course, was playing yesterday, and it's got a fine coach in Eric Musselman, and three of their five starters probably will be early NBA draft prospects this coming year, and they had five seniors starting, and at one time they were ranked in the top 10. I think they were as high as number 6. But they limped down the stretch. They really did. And, of course, yesterday they ended up losing to Florida. I guess what comes to mind is the old baseball saying that there is no joy in Mudville. Mighty Casey has struck out. And that's kind of the feeling here today. So, anyway.
Well, I was going to say you're in Reno, so you're going to feel that cloud over the city, and I understand that because Eric Musselman had another terrific year. He is really a fine, fine coach. I hear his name a lot in a lot of circles as positions open around the country. Do you think we can land Musselman and get him to come? I don't know what kind of conversations are going on, and I don't want people to get overly upset, but I do know he's so highly regarded nationally, and after all, Florida is not chopped liver. Remember, these are just numbers. The seeds are just numbers, and everybody says that's an upset. Some other people, particularly those down in Florida, would tell you that wasn't an upset. That was Florida was better. But I'm very impressed with the job that Eric has done there in Nevada, and he's done it in a very interesting way, getting some graduate transfers and older kids to play the game who have passion for the game, and are a little more mature, and that allows them to understand intellectually how to play, and that's the way Eric teaches.
Well, I agree with everything you said. He was in great demand before he took this job. He took it because he loved Reno. That's the one reason he may stay, because he is being courted. I know that. But we're going to take our first break, Stan. Audience, stay with us. Now, you're going to really learn a lot about the whole process of March Madness from this man. We'll be right back.
Old Tales of Nevada, Past and Present, a TV show that tells the story of Nevada's past, present, and future. Whether it's people, places, things, or events, we cover it all on Old Tales of Nevada, Past and Present. Why do we do it? To bring pride to those who live in this great, historic, important state of Nevada. Old Tales of Nevada, Past and Present. Watch every Sunday at 7 a.m. on the CW Network, Spectrum Channel 12 and 695, DirecTV Channel 9, and Channel 8.3 off air. Till then, have a great Nevada day.
Hi, this is Shannon with Lancaster Auto Care. At Lancaster Auto Care, we care about cars. Whether it's your classic 69 Mustang that you call your baby, your toy haul and mudslinging four-wheel drive, or your daughter's first car, you can be sure that your vehicle will be cared for the right way. We are locally owned and family operated with over 20 years of experience caring for customers' vehicles just like yours. We pride ourselves on providing the best quality service for your vehicle. So when you're on or off the road, you can be confident in knowing your car is running at peak performance and reliability. If you are looking for a friendly, honest shop that provides excellent service, stop by and see us. Visit us at Lancaster Auto Care or call us at 775-813-2276. And remember, we give discounts to our active military and veterans.
Lancaster Auto Care in their new state-of-the-art location, 56 Coney Island Drive, just one block west of the intersection of Gregg and McCarran.
It's your worldwide invite to Charbecue, the Butcher's Kitchen. Perfection, tri-tip, rib tips, and brisket. Rotisserie chicken with white sauce, all hardwood smoked. Old world sausage aged to perfection. Wood smoke fire, Charbecue, the Butcher's Kitchen. 7689 South Virginia. Call in and pick up dinner. Charbecue, the Butcher's Kitchen. Get in and get real.
Hey, Dr. Phil here. I help people solve difficult and trying personal problems every day on my TV show, but there's one problem that just got me stumped. Childhood hunger. Nearly 16 million children in America struggle with it. That's one in five kids who may not know where their next meal is coming from, despite the fact that there's more than enough healthy, nutritious food out there to feed them all. Now, I don't know about you, but that is unacceptable to me. Luckily, the Feeding America network of good people is out there collecting surplus food and giving hope to hungry children and their families at local food banks all across the country. But let's face it, they can't do it without your help. Join me in supporting Feeding America and your local food bank at feedingamerica.org.
Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council. Together, we can solve hunger. Together, we're Feeding America.
You're invited to join Business Connections with Anita every Wednesday from 10 to 11 a.m. here on 1180 a.m. KCKQ America Matters.
Are you shy and don't want to talk on the air? Text us your questions or comments to 775-237-2266. Now, back to the show.
Welcome back, folks. Omer Raines again. We have an incredible guest, Stan Morrison. We're talking March Madness. So, Stan, with your background, with your knowledge, with your experience, with your contacts, would you explain in detail what the selection committees go through? For example, let's start with how are the members of the committee chosen?
Well, Senator, first of all, there are 10 members of the committee, and they represent regions throughout the United States. And every year, two graduate and two rookies come on. I had the pleasure of going on in 2007. The other rookie with me was Gene Smith, the outstanding athletics director at Ohio State University. And it is sincerely, in my athletic administration life of 15 years at two different University of California campuses, it is the greatest honor I've ever received. It becomes family. It is so serious, and it is a truly integrity-filled group of men, and we become family. Our wives get very close. Final Four, we spend a great deal of time together, and we hold on to relationships for a very long time. And so there are a lot of people that want to be on that committee, and conferences are contacted by the committee people to see who in their conference they feel would be a good representative. It's usually an athletics director, or it could be a commissioner. They don't necessarily need to have played the game, but they need to know the game. And there are various levels of knowledge in the game. And most recently, I found no one devoid of really a strong understanding of the game. So you get a phone call. And usually after your commissioner and perhaps other athletic directors in your conference have supported the commissioner, they make contact. You've already expressed your interest in the role. And you get a phone call from the chair of the committee, and they tell you you have been selected. I want to tell you there are very few phone calls I've ever received in my life that were more enjoyable, more meaningful, and more important to me in my professional growth, and certainly in terms of serving the game of basketball than that call. I got it from Gary Waters, who was the chair of the committee. He was from Virginia. From Princeton.
How is the chair selected? By the other members of the selection committee?
No, it's a very interesting thing. At the time, Tom Dernstad, when I was on the committee, oversaw the committee, and Greg Shaheen was very, very strong in our committee. Those two, along with some really strong people from the NCAA were the people, and they would put their heads together, and they have observed the committee certainly for a number of years and see those people, number one, and the single most important factor, somebody who can afford the time. Generally speaking, that must be an athletics director from a large program that has enough assistant and associate athletic directors to free him or her up to be the chair, because you're going to be involved in cities all over the country. You're going to be involved in a number of committees. You're going to be involved with the promotion of the game. And obviously, you are the voice of the committee with the national and, then in some cases, international media. So qualifying in that regard is really important. So you can imagine, I was at UC Riverside, and we had a relatively small staff. We had transitioned from Division I to Division II. And so when you compare the University of the Pacific, UC Riverside to, for instance, an Ohio State or a Stanford or all the other schools, those are monster schools, and they, in fact, have athletics directors that can get freed up and would agree to take the chairmanship.
Okay. Now, where does the committee physically meet? And are they sequestered to prevent lobbying as they make decisions, things of that sort?
Yeah. The committee meets in Indianapolis. That's where the home base of the NCAA is, a wonderful complex there of offices. And they meet and stay at specific hotels. You're not, and there are a number of meetings through the course of the year that you fly back, and really it is 100% devotion to the task. You are assigned as a primary to three or four conferences that you're in charge of watching the lead teams. You're in charge of probably visiting every week or two with the commissioner and the sports information director of that commission, of that conference, to review the teams that are under consideration. You are also assigned three or four conferences where you are the secondary person. So you're watching those teams in the same vein, talking with, you're on the conference calls with the commissioner and the sports information director of that conference. And so you're watching a lot. And around February, there's a national meeting that's held. And at that point, we go national with what we're watching, and we are in a position to eliminate a lot of the schools and get down to a smaller list. Now, that's difficult, but how am I going to watch teams in Oklahoma, Dakota, and Florida? Well, we're given a code that allows us to get in the conference office, and the conference office is able to take in the video of every single game. And with that code, on a Wednesday afternoon, if I choose, I can watch the second half of Northwestern against Ohio State. And so we really get a chance to be up close and personal. In addition to that, direct television, direct TV, and the big disc is installed in the home of all the committee members. And so I will guarantee you, on a Saturday, I could watch parts of 20 games, and did. And I always pride myself, I think I watched more basketball than anyone in the country. And you take the job so diligently because you don't want to go to the committee and be able to demonstrate to them that you didn't see your teams, that you were assigned. And I took great pride in being able to do that. So it is formidable, the process you go through. And when we get sequestered, that is the week before the Final Four. For 4 years or 5 years, you will always have the same hotel room. So I would get off the elevator, and there's an officer stationed there. Yes, he's packing a gun, and he usually has a laptop. He's watching movies 24 hours a day. No one can get to us. Down the main hall, CBS has a room, one of the rooms that they've made into a studio for periodic interviews with the chair of the committee. And so we have the same room. They have a big dining room, kitchen, and then we have a viewing room with five or six televisions where when we have a break, we're able to watch games. One night I was in there till, Lord, it seemed like 2:30 or 3 in the morning because it was a six overtime game involving Syracuse, and I can't remember who else. I was the one guy that stayed up for all six, and it was a thrilling thing to watch, but you do get a chance to watch with each other, and there are great discussions that go on during that time.
Well, during this final week that you're discussing the critical week, what tools do you have at your disposal as a committee member? You're in a room, you're in yet there with your colleagues, and you've told us the way in which they're somewhat protected or sequestered. What tools do they have? Computers, or they can review games again? On what do they base their decision? I know they've been making decisions all along. And go ahead, please.
Okay. Well, there's a large horseshoe-shaped table, and the 10 members of the committee plus the chair. Obviously the chair is at the front end, and then right now it's Dave Gavitt, who is the godfather of the committee. Not Dave Gavitt, I'm forgetting his name. It is Gavitt. He's the son of Dave Gavitt, who built the Big East Conference. And I'm so sorry. In either case, at the end of that horseshoe, the open end, are 10 to 12 NCAA staff people who have computers. We all have laptops in front of us on the table. Inside of that horseshoe, in front of every member, are three more screens that allow us in debate, for instance, to call up. I want to see Gonzaga, and I want to see Duke, for instance. Or it could be any two teams. And immediately they click some buttons, and the two teams' records flash up. They are color-coordinated, and that shows you who won, which games they won, and which they lost. And they are divided up into three lists. The first list is top 20 teams. The next list is top 50 teams. The next list is top 100 teams. And that's based on the metrics that are used, wins and losses, and whether you played at home or on the road. The color coordination allows you to see immediately a team that played a very soft schedule. That impacts you. It immediately allows you to see a team that has played a very difficult schedule. That impacts you. Then you see who they won against and how many teams, you know, that are highly ranked were there. So during this period of time, every piece of information imaginable is there. Injuries. We know about the injuries. We know if someone has been suspended by the coach for some violation, team violation, or other reasons. All those things are factors that we are addressing in our process of evaluating and building the ultimate tournament of 68 teams.
San, let me interrupt only because we need to take another commercial break. We'll be right back, audience. Stay with us. This gets more and more interesting.
Hi there. Roy Marshall here to welcome you to our new world-famous Marshall Mint at the Reno Town Mall. You'll find gold and silver bars, the V&T Railroad, Wild Mustangs, and Angels of the Day medallions. One-of-a-kind estate jewelry, Morgan dollars, fashion golden quartz jewelry. See the free museum with precious stones and crystals from all over the world. Marshall Mint, now open in Reno at the Reno Town Mall.
Once a powerful leader in the world of finance and insurance, a now retired Jim Stannard has taken on a new role as a singer-songwriter, fulfilling a dream that has burned for more than four decades, working with platinum-selling rocker Kip Winger and Afghan Whigs guitarist John Skibik to bring his songs to life. His debut release, Bucket List, has been met with enthusiasm. CD Baby syndicated writer Tony Mastriani wrote, "This album is refreshing and most probably more interesting than what you've been listening to this year. It is my sleeper pick for best independent label album thus far in 2018. Jim Hines from Make a Scene agreed. Some gems here. Stannard has both a gift for poetry and narrative, drawing from a well of influences that include such diverse artists as Warren Zevon, The Who, David Bromberg, and Robert Earl Keane. Bucket List's 11 original songs makes up what Roots Music Report calls a grows on you set from a fresh and highly believable voice. Order your copy at jimstannardmusic.com or download wherever digital music is sold.
Business owners and entrepreneurs know that good information is priceless. Just one great idea can make all the difference. Hi, this is Joe Morabito, host of CEO Business Mind. Each week, in one fast-paced hour, we share lots of proven tips and ideas to help you be more successful in business. Don't miss a minute of CEO Business Mind with me, Joe Morabito, right here on 1180 AM KCKQ.
Hi, I'm Bill Kendall. I practice law in Northern Nevada for over 25 years, and I specialize in representing injured people in their fights for just compensation and in representing parents in custody and visitation disputes. I've tried over 20 jury trials to verdict. I've arbitrated or mediated hundreds of personal injury cases on behalf of clients to successful conclusions, and I have personally handled every single case from start to finish. I am also a court-appointed mediator for the Washoe County Family Court Division, where I help parents negotiate custody and visitation plans. With me as your attorney, you can rest assured that your case will be handled competently and that I will be responsive to all of your needs and questions. My goal in every case is to have clients that are satisfied with the outcome of their case and who would recommend me to others. Give me a call at 775-324-6464 or visit my website, BillKendallLaw.com. My number again is 775-324-6464.
This is America Matters Media on AM 1180 KCKQ, a Lotus broadcast station. The power of radio since 1967.
Want to expand your advertising dollar? Sponsor this or any America Matters program by calling 775-827-8900, extension 2. Now back to the show.
Hello, folks. Welcome back again. Omer Raines here, fabulous guest Stan Morrison, and we are talking March Madness. So, Stan, let me ask you this. How are the teams assigned to various brackets? For example, we'll use Nevada again. Nevada's in the South region this year, or was before being eliminated yesterday. And Nevada is clearly a Western team, but yet it's playing in the South. And that's true of teams all over the country. How does that happen? How are teams assigned to these various brackets?
Sure. Let's just take it this way. Let's take the top four teams, and without mentioning teams, so team number, you have four teams that are ranked number one, and they are in the order that the committee sees them. So we take the very first team, and we have four regionals, and that very first team is assigned to the closest as the crow flies region to their campus. Okay, so that person, okay, then number two is assigned to the closest region to their campus. Now we have two teams left, and we have two regions left. The third, number one, is assigned to the closest region to their campus, and the fourth, number one, takes what's left. So it's just the way it happens.
Okay, now all that makes sense, but then after the four number one seeds, how do you select these teams that follow?
The same way. In terms of the regional placement, it's exactly the same way. If you can imagine an S curve, and we just put those four number ones, 1, 2, 3, 4, on the one line, then we put number five under four, and we go right to left. So that means 6 would be under 3, and 7 would be under 2, and 8 would be under 1. And that's seeding. So let's say we had an 8-team tournament, and you seeded it. 1 would play 8, 2 would play 7, 3 would play 6, and 4 would play 5. That's exactly what happens with the 64-team seeding that we've seen. And so they maintain an S curve, and it goes down all the way back and forth. And so you have, 16 lines of four teams. And so the committee will do that 1 through 64. Now, a lot of teams are automatic. They didn't have to play, and they won their conference, and maybe they were a one team conference, one school. Like in the Big West out here, UC Irvine is in the NCAA tournament. They're tied right now at halftime. They were, I think, a 13 seed. That process is a lot of their seeding is usually lower. A one seed, pardon me, one team conference is probably not going to be as strong a conference, obviously, as a conference that has five, six, seven, even eight teams. And so people wonder, well, gee, you've got three ACC teams and the one seed. Well, those are three of the strongest, according to the committee. And the committee takes immense time and there's immense pressure in that room. You can't believe the not arguments, the discussions. Because I was one of the few coaches that the few people on the committee who had actually coached, often they said, Stan, we've got these two teams. And I would go shirts against skins, neutral court. And guys who played ball understand shirts against skins. And I would start by evaluating guard play. Guard play is so critical in the NCAA tournament. Next thing I would talk about with respect to those guards is turnover to assist ratio. Where they had, you know, the team averages 25 assists and 15 turnovers. So you figure that out. And then I would go to rebounding next. That's my personal evaluation. And as I make that evaluation and comparison between those two, then I would give my answer to their question on shirts against skin. When you go through the S-curve, you're listing, sometimes you really have a difficult time. I mean a truly difficult time. Sometimes they might shift two teams on the same line. Let's say we're on the four line. And it's better in terms of holding to the committee principles of getting you close to your closest geographical area. Many times they will flip-flop too. So say you were the second school on the four line, we're going to flip-flop you with the third school because that gives the committee the opportunity to have you stationed closer to your campus when you play in your regional. I hope that makes sense.
But I assume that if you do that minor flip-flop, the teams would be so close together in ranking that it's justified.
Yeah. And it is absolutely just. Sometimes they will argue, no, they're not that close, and so we're not going to do that. The fact remains there is diligent effort to allow schools to play as close to their home campus as possible in that regional. Now, if I were to bring a coach in the room and I'd say to coach, I've got a chance to move you from the one line down to the two line so you could play closer to your campus. Do you want to be a one seed and play a 16, or do you want to be a two seed and play a 15? And I'll guarantee you 99% of the time, they're going to say, keep me on the one line. There are coaches who,
except Virginia last year.
Yeah, exactly, and that is the magic. The whole country gets caught up on numbers, a line. You know, you're going to put five people on the court. You're going to play this game, and it's going to be officiated, and they are going to keep score. You have to do it between the lines. So once you come out to play, forget that, and don't let it affect your psyche either way. Oh, this is easy. They're just a 16. Yeah, you tell that to, Coach Bennett. You know,
right.
Last year that was awful for him, and they played a tough team, and they got upset. So that'll happen, and so that's why. But the seeding is done. They hold to the principle. We will get you to the closest regional possible, and if the seeding says that you're above that guy, you're going to get the first choice on the closest remaining seed, regional, and that's the way it works.
Okay, let me ask you, break down this year's brackets for us. I will say the following, that most years, one bracket seems as though it's better. That may not be the case, but one bracket usually jumps out. That's not true this year when I review it. I mean, they really look as though there's parity across the board. So how do you see the brackets this year?
Yeah, I would agree. I think that's a great assessment. Let me tell you about the formula of six, okay? tournament, we get the final four. And there's a theory called the formula of six. And if you get, if you total the seeds of the four teams in there, and you have six or less, the committee is considered genius level, okay? And that is really an interesting thing. So if you had four number one seeds, you're a total of four. If you had two twos and two ones, that's a total of six, and it doesn't get any better than that. And I was really fortunate, my first and second year, both my first and second years, we had a four and a six, and people couldn't believe it. And we were very, the committee is very proud. All right, let's have someone break in there. Let's have an 11 get in there. And say you had 11 with 3-1. Guess what? You're 14. Whoa, did you screw it up? No. 11 played their rear ends off. And that's why you can't get overly involved. You can't get seduced by those numbers. You must lace them up and go on that court and block off on the boards and play defense and run your offense and don't throw the ball to the lady with blue hair in the third row. Take care of the ball. That's why guard play is so important, at least from where I sit. So the formula of six is alive and well. And I look at this right now, and I'm going to go through each one of the regions very quickly. In the South region, Virginia is the number one seed. Tennessee is the number two seed. Okay? And that's very interesting. That's good. The number three seed is right there, Purdue. And Purdue won yesterday. And the number four seed is Kansas State. And they're tied right now at halftime with UC Irvine. They're tied. I think it's 30-30. I'll give a shot at the buzzer. And Irvine really has a good team. They've won 30 games this season. They played a pretty good schedule. So that gives you, I think that that's valid with Virginia and Tennessee. I kind of raised my eyebrows. I'm looking at Villanova at number six. They've been there. Now, they're not as good as they were last year. And Villanova won yesterday in a very close game with a very well-coached St. Mary's team. Coach Bennett at Randy Bennett at St. Mary's is being talked about a lot, much like Eric Musselman.
I thought so Villanova they were lucky yesterday to win that game against St. Mary's, I thought.
I saw St. Mary's beat Gonzaga for the conference championship. It's the best coach game by a coach that I saw this year. In fact, I sent him a note. I said, that's the best. He controlled the tempo in that game, would not permit Gonzaga to run. And it was an exceptional coaching effort on his part. But they didn't get it done yesterday. And Villanova is so good down the stretch. And Villanova's guard play was terrific. And that was great. Let's move on over to the West.
Well, before we do that, we're going to take our very last commercial break. We'll be right back, folks, as we continue breaking down these brackets. Stay with us.
Low-dose chemotherapy uses only 10 to 20% of full-dose chemo, and it's known as IPT, or insulin potentiated therapy. It's one of the safest and most innovative approaches to treating cancer effectively. IPT virtually eliminates side effects of full-dose chemo, such as nausea, hair loss, and fatigue. Could IPT be the answer you've been searching for? To find out, call Dr. Dan Royal at 702-562-1454. IPT uses low-dose chemo with insulin. Cancer cells have up to 20 times more insulin receptors and use up to 20 times more sugar than normal cells. That's why cancer cells thrive while normal cells struggle to survive. One study showed that using low-dose chemo with insulin resulted in a 10,000% increase in cancer-killing ability. Could IPT with low-dose chemo and insulin help you? Call Dr. Royal at 702-562-1454 to see if you qualify for IPT. That's 702-562-1454.
Do you need high-quality estate planning and family law services? I'm Reno attorney Todd Torvinen. I practice in the areas of estate planning, probate, family law, and divorce taxation. I'm also experienced in probate and family law litigator and believe that prevailing in any litigation requires diligent, methodical preparation. As a certified estate planning law specialist and certified public accountant, I'm singularly qualified to analyze the financial aspects of marital, family assets, or a decedent's estate. A large part of my practice is done in real time. It means that preparation of estate planning and family law documents occurs with the client present, and they're reviewed with the client at the time the client is there. Your documents are examined line by line and explained to you, then modified based upon your input. This client-focused approach leverages the current technology and enhances the attorney-client communication and relationship. The idea is to produce a better product. Please call me at 775-825-6066 to schedule an appointment today. Again, 775-825-6066.
The Delta and Bonanza Saloons in Virginia City are simply elegant. Imagine ascending the grand staircase and being surrounded by the Victorian elegance and grandeur of the historic banquet rooms. Original crystal chandeliers, mahogany bars, and oak dance floors highlight the eloquently appointed spaces. A truly romantic and unique setting for your wedding, banquets, or holiday parties. Detailed ceremony and menu planning ensures your special event is a memorable occasion. With just one call to Jesse at 775-847-0789, all of your arrangements will be handled by their experienced staff, with your every expectation in mind, including cakes, flowers, photography, videography, music, and party amenities. Complete ceremony and reception packages are available, as well as their famous themed weddings. Since 1865, the Delta and Bonanza Saloon's guests have come from every state in the Union. Now it's your turn. No event is too large or too small. Let the Delta and Bonanza Saloon's plan your next incredible event. Call Jesse at 775-847-0789.
Find out what's hot and happening. Join Lady J for Smooth Jazz Tune-Up.
Join me Saturdays, 10 to noon, here on America Matters.
Unable to listen to the whole show? A recording of today's program will be available later today. Visit americamatters.us and click on the podcast link. Now, back to the show.
Welcome back again, folks. Omar Raines here with a great guest, Stan Morrison. We are talking March Madness. Stan, we're going to have to move quickly. You had talked about the South bracket. Tell us about the West bracket. In fact, each of the other three, real quickly.
You bet. Gonzaga's the number one pick, and I've got them going all the way to the Final Four. Michigan is number two in the West. They're playing very well. Had a nice win yesterday. And they're going to play Florida. I see a number. So Florida State is the four pick, and they're my Cinderella team. I think they are so deep. They have two people in double figures, like 13 and 11. They are so deep, long, lean, and tough. And you do not want them defending you. I think that is the team to watch. And tomorrow they're going to take on Murray State with this wonderful young player, Ja Morant, who is a terrific scorer and has been projected as high as number two in the draft. Moving on, and Baylor are going to go tomorrow. That'll be a terrific game, too. In the East, Duke is number one, and I think rightly so. And Michigan State is number two. A lot of people thought they were disgruntled that the Big Ten was not represented in the top four number one seeds. And Michigan State had a tough game yesterday with Bradley. I think that's part of the residual, the fatigue from emotional fatigue from winning the Big Ten tournament. So we'll watch Michigan State. Tom Izzo's got his club going really well. And I think that this East, I see Duke and Michigan State moving on and going all the way to the Final Four. Then we end up in the Midwest, and in the Midwest we've got North Carolina at number one. I see them as the Final Four team. Kentucky, I think they're even beginning of season now. These kids know how to play each other, and they are really difficult to figure out in this entire picture. And they're playing Wofford. Wofford had a wonderful yesterday in Seton Hall, and most people in the world don't know where Wofford is. They're finding out right now. Watch out for Kansas. Bill Self, boy, he's got the adrenaline going right now. And Bill Self has been in this tournament forever and did not win his conference, but he's number four, and I would watch out for him. I think, you know, when we look at everything here, I'm exactly. I feel good about North Carolina in there. And now that fourth team, I'm not sure. Will it be Kentucky? I don't know. Will it be Virginia? I don't know. There are a lot of
You're breaking out on us quite badly, Stan. Are you there? Hello?
This is before that Final Four is played.
Let's go on. You broke out on us. I don't know if you covered the fourth bracket or not, but I will ask this. It's what do you make of the fact that three of the four number one seeds come from the same conference, the ACC?
Yeah, I just think that, number one, they've had incredible visibility. The Western, Midwestern and Western teams get to see them all the time. The West doesn't deserve any, from what I've seen, any more of the seeding that they currently have. But the rest of the country gets to see them, and all the committee gets to see their games. If you're in the West, you're seeing a game at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. So you know those.
You're breaking out again.
I'm so sorry. Can you hear me?
I can now, yes.
Okay. They are gifted, talented teams. And they deserve the seeding from where I – my only concern was about Michigan State. Michigan State, I think, is a seed in the second.
Well, you know, it's understood that the Blue Bloods usually rule – but there is always a Cinderella story or two that captures the imagination of the country. And you mentioned Florida State. I don't know that I would consider that a Cinderella story because they're in a major conference and they're dang good and we know it. But in any event, who do you predict will be the Cinderella story this year, in addition to the one you've mentioned, if any?
Well, I honestly, I don't think of any of them as, you know, obviously, in the West, they're rooting for UC Irvine, and that would be one of them. They're very well coached, and they have size and depth, and they can shoot the ball. I think they're a fine defensive team, and so UC Irvine would have a shot. I don't see them going to the Elite Eight. They might have a shot at going to the round of 16. And then looking at their schedule, I can't find – there it is, Irvine – they're playing Kansas State right now. Then they would play the winner of Wisconsin, Oregon, if they were to get there. I think that they could compete with Wisconsin and Oregon and perhaps get to the Sweet 16. At that point, I would expect Virginia to be there, and they would be bigger and stronger physically than Virginia. But I think Virginia would take that game. So I have Irvine with a shot to get to the Sweet 16.
You know, before the tournament started, I predicted – and many people know this, that UCI Anteaters, and that is the name, is going to be the Cinderella team this year.
Oh, good for you.
And people said, what? And I mean, if UCI Anteaters can make it, who's next? The Santa Cruz Banana Slugs? I mean.
Well, they're not Division I.
Right, that's correct.
And, yeah. Quite frankly, I don't think Santa Cruz takes things very seriously in athletics.
Not when it comes to sports.
No. Yeah.
Well, anyway.
This is a formidable tournament.
Well, you and I are going to have a Final Four program in 2 weeks. That will be right before the Final Four weekend. And you're going to be in Minneapolis for the Final Four. And so at this early stage, I'm going to ask you to give us your pre-tournament picks. Who do you think will emerge from each of the four? You've kind of touched upon that. Well, go ahead, and then I'll tell you what my thought is.
Okay. I think out of the South, the South is the single most difficult one for me to pick. Okay, Virginia's the number one pick. Tennessee is number two. I think someone else is going to come out of this particular region. Okay, Iowa obviously lost today. Keep your eye on Villanova. Purdue is very, very well coached. But I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to go ahead and have an all-timer for you. I think Villanova comes out of the South.
Hmm. Okay.
Because he's been there, and he can coach. Man, can he? And that isn't to say that Tony Bennett can't coach, That isn't to say that these other people can't coach, but I have a feeling about Villanova. I don't know why. I've seen them play several times this year, and I watched them struggle early. Out of the West, I see absolutely Gonzaga. That's my pick. Michigan is good. John Beilein is just doing a great job with that Michigan team. They continue to improve. Out of the East, Duke or Michigan State, and I see Duke simply because Michigan State strength is on the board, and Duke has the transcendent player the last 10 years in Zion Williamson. He is an exceptional talent. His quickness, his unselfishness, his passing, his second jump, his first step for a man that size, his skill level is extraordinary, and I have Duke advancing to the Final Four. And out of the Midwest, absolutely I have North Carolina going. I think North Carolina is destined to go to the Final Four. And next week, or in 2 weeks, I'll let you know who I think is going to win the whole thing.
Okay. I'm going to tell you very quickly that I agree with three of your four. You know, I would go with Gonzaga in the West, with North Carolina in the Midwest. And if Zion Williamson is well, and they say he is, Duke in the East, and probably the national winner. But where I disagree is in the South. I think it's going to be Tennessee. I think Virginia, once again, is going to be upset. So
Well, that could happen.
So we'll see how that works out. I have many other things I would like to discuss with you, but I guess we have to wind this up. I do want to comment, because they are extraordinary players. Ja Morant was the best player I saw yesterday, and I watched a lot of games. He is incredible. I had read about him. I became a believer after watching him yesterday. What a talent. The other one I want to mention...
I saw him in a game.
Yeah, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I saw him in a game, and Magic Johnson walked in to watch him. And the kid threw a couple of Magic Johnson-like passes. And yesterday, he threw a left-handed pass from out on top that was extraordinary. He is really a gifted guy who understands the game and sees things that most people never see, and he's able to deliver. He can get to the rim. His outside shooting is somewhat suspect, but that's okay. He does so many other things, and he'll improve as an outside shooter.
Well, he had a triple-double with, what, did he have 19 assists or something like that? It's crazy. The other one that ought to be mentioned is Fletcher McGee, who set an all-time three-point record for NCAA basketball. Incredible shot maker. Thank you very much, Stan. We'll see you in 2 weeks, and we're going to analyze and evaluate the Final Four. Thank you, folks, for listening.